Dr. Faustus by Christopher Marlowe. Character list: Faustus himself. He sells his soul to the devil. Faustus, a brilliant man, who seems to have reached the limits of natural knowledge. Faustus is a scholar of the early 16th century in the German city of Wittenberg. He is arrogant, fiery, and possesses a thirst for knowledge. As an intellectual, Faustus is familiar with things, like demon summoning and astrology, not normally considered academic subjects by today's universities. Faustus decides to sell his soul to the devil in exchange for earthly power and knowledge and an additional 24 years of life. He proceeds to waste this time on self-indulgence and low tricks. Faustus is the absolute center of the play, which has few truly developed characters. Mephistopheles, from the Hebrew, Mephits, destroyer, and Tophel, liar. A devil of craft and cunning. He is the devil who comes at Faustus' summoning, and the devil who serves Faustus for 24 years. In lore, Mephistopheles, also spelled Mephistopheles or Mephistopheles and also called Mephisto, seems to be a relative latecomer in the recognized hierarchy of demons. He possibly was created for the Faustus legend. In Marlowe's play, Mephistopheles has layers to his personality. He admits that separation from God is anguish, and is capable of fear and pain. But he is gleefully evil, participating at every level in Faustus' destruction. Not only does Mephistopheles get Faustus to sell his soul, he also encourages Faustus to waste his 24 years of power. Wagner, servant to Faustus. He steals Faustus' books and learns how to summon demons. At the end of the play, he seems concerned about his master's fate. Good angel and evil angel personifications of Faustus' inner turmoil, who give differing advice to him at key points. Their characters also reflect Christian belief that humans are assigned guardian angels, and that devils can influence human thoughts. Valdez, friend to Faustus, who teaches him the dark arts. He appears only in Act 1. Cornelius, friend to Faustus, who teaches him the dark arts. He appears only in Act 1. Lucifer, Satan. Lucifer original meant Venus, referring to the planet's brilliance. In Christian lore, Lucifer is sometimes thought to be another name of Satan. Some traditions say that Lucifer was Satan's name before the fall, while the fathers of the Catholic Church held that Lucifer was not Satan's proper name but a word showing the brilliance and beauty of his station before the fall. He appears at a few choice moments in Dr. Faustus, and Marlowe uses Lucifer as Satan's proper name. Beelzebub, one of Lucifer's officers. A powerful demon. The seven deadly sins personifications of the seven deadly sins, not acts but impulses or motivations that lead men to sinful actions. They array themselves in a pageant before Faustus, although scholars think now that this section was not written by Marlowe. Clown slash Robin, Robin learns demon summoning by stealing one of Faustus' books. He is the chief character in a number of scenes that provide comic relief from the main story. Dick, a friend of Robin's. He is one of the characters peopling the few comic relief scenes. Rafe, a horse ostler or groomer and friend to Robin. With the clown, he summons Mephistopheles, who is none too pleased to be called. Vintner, a wine merchant or a winemaker. This vintner chases down Robin and Rafe after they steal a silver goblet from him. Carter, a man who meets Faustus while carting hay to town. Faustus swindles him. Horse courser, a man who buys Faustus' horse. Faustus swindles him. Hostess, an ale wench. She treats Robin and his friends kindly. The Pope, yeah, that pope. In a move that would have pleases his Protestant audience, Marlowe depicts him as cruel, power-mad, and far from holy. Faustus plays some cheap tricks on him. Bruno, a man who would be pope, selected by the German emperor and representing the conflicts between church and state authority. Raymond, King of Hungary. He serves the pope. Charles, the German emperor. Faustus performs at his court. Martino, knight in the court of the German emperor. Friend to Benvolio and Frederick. When Benvolio seeks revenge against Faustus, Martino decides to help out of loyalty. Frederick, knight in the court of the German emperor. Friend to Martino and Benvolio. When Benvolio seeks revenge against Faustus, Frederick decides to help out of loyalty. Benvolio, knight in the court of the German emperor. Friend to Martino and Frederick. When Faustus humiliates him, he seeks revenge. Saxony, a man attending at the court of the German emperor. Duke of Vanholt, a nobleman. Faustus performs illusions at his court. Duchess of Vanholt, a noblewoman. Faustus fetches her grapes in January. Spirits in the shapes of Alexander the Great, Darius, Paramour, and Helen Faustus illusions. An old man, a holy old man. He tries to save Faustus by getting him to repent, and for his good deed, Faustus initially thanks him. But later, Faustus sends devils to harm the old man. Themes: man's limitations and potential, the possible range of human accomplishment is at the heart of Dr. Faustus, and many of the other themes are auxiliary to this one. The axis of this theme is the conflict between Greek or Renaissance worldviews, and the Christian worldview that has held sway throughout the medieval period. As Europe emerged from the Middle Ages, contact with previously lost Greek learning had a revelatory effect on man's conception of himself. While the Christian worldview places man below God, and requires obedience to him, the Greek worldview places man at the center of the universe. For the Greeks, man defies the gods at his own peril, but man has nobility that no deity can match. Dr. Faustus, scholar and lover of beauty, chafes at the bit of human limitation. He seeks to achieve godhood himself, and so he leaves behind the Christian conceptions of human limitation. Though he fancies himself to be a seeker of Greek greatness, we see quickly that he is not up to the task. Pride, and sin — pride is one of the seven deadly sins, arguable the one that leads to all the others. Within the Christian framework, pride is a lethal motivation because it makes the sinner forget his fallen state. For Christians, men are fallen since birth, because they carry with them the taint of original sin. A man made haughty with pride forgets that he shares Eve's sin, and must therefore be saved by the gift of grace. Only God, through Christ, can dispense this grace, and the man who forgets that fact deprives himself of the path to salvation. Faustus' first great sin is pride. He does not stop there. Reflecting the Christian view, pride gives rise to all of the other sins, and ends ironically with the proud man's abasement. Faustus goes quickly from pride to all of the other sins, becoming increasingly petty and low. Flesh and spirit — the division between flesh and spirit was stronger in Greek thought than in Hebrew thought, but Christians adapted the divide into their own belief system. While Westerners now take this conception of being for granted, the flesh-slash-spirit divide is not a feature of many of the world's major belief systems. Nor is the flesh-slash-spirit divide necessary for belief in the afterlife. Both Hindus and Buddhists conceive of the human entity differently, while retaining belief in life after death. In Christianity, flesh and spirit are divided to value the later and devalue the former. Faustus' problem is that he values his flesh, and the pleasure it can provide him, while failing to look after the state of his soul. Damnation, damnation is eternal. Eternal hell is another concept that Westerners take for granted as part of religion, but again this belief's uniqueness needs to be appreciated. While the Jewish view of the afterlife was somewhat vague, Christians developed the idea of judgment after death. Muslims adapted a similar conception of hell and heaven, and to this day eternal hell and eternal heaven remain an important feature of Christianity and Islam. While Buddhists and Hindus have hell in their belief systems, for the most part in neither religion is hell considered eternal. For example, an eternal hell in Mahayana Buddhism would contradict Buddhist beliefs about transience and the saving power of Buddha's compassion. Not so in Christianity. If Faustus dies without repenting and accepting God, he will be damned forever. As we learn from Mephistopheles, hell is not merely a place, but separation from God's love. Salvation, mercy, and redemption, hell is eternal, but so is heaven. For a Christian, all that is necessary to be saved from eternal damnation is acceptance of Jesus Christ's grace. Even after signing away his soul to the devil, Faustus has the option of repentance that will save him from hell. But once he has committed himself to his own damnation, Faustus seems unable to change his course. While Christianity seems to accept even a deathbed repentance as acceptable for the attainment of salvation, Marlowe plays with that idea, possibly rejecting it for his own thematic purposes. Valuing knowledge over wisdom, Faustus has a thirst for knowledge, but he seems unable to acquire wisdom. Faustus' thirst for knowledge is impressive, but it is overshadowed by his complete inability to understand certain truths. Because of this weakness, Faustus cannot use his knowledge to better himself or his world. He ends life with a head full of facts, and vital understanding gained too late to save him. Talk and action, Faustus is, with no exceptions, beautiful when he speaks and contemptible when he acts. His opening speeches about the uses to which he'll put his power are exhilarating, but once he gains near omnipotence he squanders 24 years in debauchery and petty tricks. This gap between high talk and low action seems related to the fault of valuing knowledge over wisdom. While Faustus has learned much of the Greek world's learning, he has not really understood what he's been reading. He can talk about potential and plans in terms of a Greek worldview, but he lacks the internal strength to follow through on his purported goals. Symbols, the good angel and the evil angel. The angels appear at Faustus's shoulder early on in the play, the good angel urging him to repent and serve God, the evil angel urging him to follow his lust for power and serve Lucifer. The two symbolize his divided will, part of which wants to do good and part of which is sunk in sin. Blood plays multiple symbolic roles in the play. When Faustus signs away his soul, he signs in blood, symbolizing the permanent and supernatural nature of this pact. His blood congeals on the page, however, symbolizing, perhaps, his own body's revolt against what he intends to do. Meanwhile, Christ's blood, which Faustus says he sees running across the sky during his terrible last night, symbolizes the sacrifice that Jesus, according to Christian belief, made on the cross. This sacrifice opened the way for humankind to repent its sins and be saved. Faustus, of course, in his proud folly, fails to take this path to salvation. Faustus's rejection of the ancient authorities, in scene 1, Faustus goes through a list of the major fields of human knowledge, logic, medicine, law, and theology, and cites for each an ancient authority, Aristotle, Galen, Justinian, and Jerome's Bible, respectively. He then rejects all of these figures in favor of magic. This rejection symbolizes Faustus's break with the medieval world, which prized authority above all else, in favor of a more modern spirit of free inquiry, in which experimentation and innovation trumped the assertions of Greek philosophers and the Bible.